بسم الله والحمد لله والصلاة والسلام على رسول الله. We continue إن شاء الله reading from the Path of Worshippers من هاج العابدين by Imam al-Ghazali رحمه الله. And we have many strong men there are who are deprived of sustenance and remain ever poor. How often many weak men there are who come from ocean depths with a handful of gems in store. This is an indication and evidence that God has placed in creation a hidden mystery that mere creatures cannot uncover. وكم من قوي قوي في تقلبه عنه الرزق منحرف وكم ضعيف ضعيف في تقلبه كأنه من خليج البحر يغترف. هذا دليل أن الإله له في الخلق سر خفي ليس ينكشف. So whatever you are basically taking the ideas though the gems are mentioned and definitely people could dive and take pairs. In general, the idea a strong person might be devoid of plenty of sustenance. It is inevitable that someone will have enough sustenance one way or the other, but not too much of it, let's say. And the weak who might be considered, you know, insignificant, he is not going to make it, for example. That's what people might say, and he would prove them wrong, not because of he's strong or that he has gimmicks or he has plans that people do not have. No, كأنه من خليج البحر يغترف. It's as if he as if he's getting sustenance simply almost, I think, like the probably in English would say, he's getting truckloads as a metaphor, as if. Then the question is, and it's a very interesting question that Imam Ghazali asked, and it has been discussed in Sufi literature. فإن قلت هل ندخل البعدية بلا زاد? Do we, the hypothetical question is, do we enter the desert without sustenance, without provisions, without food, without drink? فاعلم أنه إذا إن كان لك قوة القلب بالله والثقة البالغة بوعد الله فادخل، وإلا فكن كالعوام بعلائقهم. وقد سمعت الإمام أبا المعالي رحمه الله يقول: إن من جرى مع الله تعالى على عادة الناس جرى الله تعالى معه ما هو عادة الناس في كفاية المعنى. هذا كلام حسن جدا وفيه فوائد جمة لمن تأملها. If it is said, should a man travel in the desert without provisions? Imam Ghazali answers by saying, know that you can do so if you rely on God wholeheartedly. Otherwise, like ordinary people, rely on your provisions and trust them. Indeed, I heard Imam Abu al-Ma'ali al-Juwayni, Imam Ghazali's Shaykh, may God have mercy on him, say, if a man deals with God the same way that he deals with other people in matters of sustenance, God will deal with him the same way that people do. Indeed, this is a profound statement, and there are great benefits in it for a man of reflection. And I think this question, and of course the answer, are important, but the fear is not to understand really what Imam Razali is saying, and just after a couple of paragraphs, we'll have Imam Razali will shed more light. Nevertheless, we'll try to unpack what is said, and if there is a critique of the idea. Okay. If it is said, does not God say and take provisions, but the best provision is piety and fearing God. فإن قلت أليس الله تعالى يقول وتزودوا فإن خير الزاد التقوى. There are two possible meanings. Imam Razali says, فعلم أن فيه قولين أحدهما أنه زاد الآخرة ولذلك قال خير زاد التقوى ولم يقل حطام الدنيا وأسبابها والثاني أنه كان قوم لا يأخذون زادا في طريق الحج لأنفسهم اتكالا على الناس ويسألون ويلحون ويؤذون الناس فأمروا بالزاد أمر تنبيه رواه البخاري وخرج البخاري من قول ابن عباس رضي الله عنهما If it is said, does not God say and take provisions? But the best provision is piety and fearing God. Remember that he says, know that there are two interpretations of this verse. The first one denotes that the verse refers to provision for the hereafter. And that is why it refers to piety and being God-fearing as the best provision. It does not refer to worldly possessions. And means. In fact, yes, worldly possessions and means. The moment he said "hutam al-dunya," as if considering everything in this world as junk. It's a metaphor for the, what is important and what is not important, the priorities. So, if it's material, it's as if one talks about junk. حطام. It does not refer to worldly possessions and means. The second interpretation is that it refers to some people who did not take provisions for themselves on their way to make pilgrimage to Mecca. This is originally. Comes from a hadith that Imam Bukhari mentioned in his Sahih from the narration of Ibn Abbas. They relied on other people. So what did they do? They relied on other people and disturbed them by begging for food. Therefore, God commanded them to take their provisions. In the hadith originally, they were coming from Yemen. It is a command that warns people and denotes that it is better to have one's provision, to have one's provisions from one's own wealth, than rely on other people. This is how we should interpret this verse. Yes. على أن أخذ الزاد من مالك خير من أخذ مال الناس والاتكال عليهم. So, كذلك نقول. So the same position of Imam Razali. If it is said, then the hypothetical question. فالمتوكل هل يحمل زاد معه في الأسفار أم لا؟ Should a man who places full trust in God take provisions in his journey or not? فاعلم أنه ربما يحمل الزاد ولا يعلق القلب به لأنه لا محالة رازقه. فاعلم أنه ربما يحمل الزاد ولا يعلق القلب به بأنه لا محالة رزقه وفيه قوامه. إنما يعلق القلب بالله تعالى يتوكل عليه ويقول إن الرزق مقسوم مفروغ منه، والله تعالى إن شاء أقام بنيتي بهذا أو بغيره. وربما يحمل بنية وربما يحمل بنية أخرى بأن يعين مسلما أو نحو ذلك. ليس الشأن في أخذ الزاد وتركه، إنما الشأن في القلب. لا تعلق قلبك إلا بوعد الله تعالى وحسن كفايته وضمانه، فكم من حامل الزاد قلبه مع الله تعالى دون الزاد، كم من تارك للزاد وقلبه مع الزاد دون الله تعالى. فالشأن إذن في القلب، فافهم هذه الأصول تكفى المعنى إن شاء الله تعالى. Yes. So if it is said, should a man who places his full trust in God take provisions in his journeys? The answer, know that a man may always take his provisions with him, but should not match or should not attach really his heart to his provisions. Rather, he must attach his heart to God Most High and rely on Him and trust Him. He must say to himself, sustenance is already ordained. If God wills to maintain my well-being with this provision or with something else, He will. I think the idea is not something else, when in the sense of it's either chicken or beef. No, that's not really the option. It's either provisions or, as it is said again in Arabic, أقام بنيتي بهذا أو بغيره. The meaning, the implication here is without, like without resorting to material, provisions. And I think there is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam that my Lord feeds me and He provides me. Yes. الحديث is إني أبيت يطعم ربي ويسقين. نعم. So it's either you talk about strength, like being empowered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, or simply the other meaning is to consider it as literally, like literally, this is the case. Yes. So know that a man may always take his provisions with him, but should not attach his heart to his provisions. Rather, he must attach his heart to God Most High and rely on Him and trust Him. He must say to himself, sustenance is already ordained if God wills to maintain my well-being with this provision or with something else. He will. A man may take provisions with him to perhaps help another Muslim and the like. Therefore, what is important is not whether to take provisions or not, but rather not to have his heart attached to anything except God's promise and its sufficiency and reliability. There are so many people who may carry their provisions, but their hearts are with God and not with their provisions. Similarly, there are so many people who do not carry their provisions, but their hearts are with the provisions and not with God. Therefore, what is important is the state of the heart. You must understand these principles, and God willing, they will be sufficient regarding the issue of provisions. If it is said, فإن قيل فالنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم كان يحمل الزاد وكذلك الصحابة والسلف الصالح. So the hypothetical question now, should a man, now it's about the Prophet, Prophet Muhammad صلى الله عليه وسلم. If it is said, surely the Messenger of God, peace upon him, carried his own provisions, and so did his companions, and righteous men of the past, we shall say that it is permissible, mubah, and it is not against the law, haram, to carry one's provisions. You must understand this and not question the messenger when God addressed him and said in the Quran, put thy trust in the living God, the undying, and proclaim his praise. Yes. Could the messenger have rebelled against such command and attached his heart to food and drink or money and wealth? Never. ثم ما ظنك برسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم حيث قال الله تعالى له وتوكل الحي الذي لا يموت أعصاه في ذلك وعلق قلبه بطعام أو شراب أو درهم أو دينار كلا وحاش أن يكون ذلك بل كان قلبه مع الله تعالى وتوكله على الله تعالى فإنه الذي لم يلتفت إلى الدنيا بأسرها ولم يمد يده إلى مفاتيح خزائن الأرض كلها وإنما كان أخذ الزاد منه وإنما كان أخذ الزاد منه ومن السلف الصالح بنيات الخير لا لميل قلوبهم عن الله تعالى إلى الزاد والمعتبر القصد على ما علمناك فانتبه من رقبتك. So never, surely he could never do that, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. Rather, his heart was always with God and his trust in him as God had commanded. Indeed, he was a man who never turned his eye to the world and never extended his hand to the keys of the earth's treasures, taking provisions by him, his companions, and the righteous men of past times. Was for good intentions. It was not due to turning their hearts from God to provisions. This is an important lesson that we can teach you and therefore understand it. Take heed and wake up from your sleep. Ask for forgiveness for your negligence and forgetfulness, and God will guide you if He wills. So the question now, if it is said, which action is better, taking or not taking provisions? فإن قلت أيهما أفضل أخذ الزاد أم تركه? So الآنسر فاعلم أن هذا يختلف باختلاف الحال. إن كان مقتدًا به يريد أن يبين أن أخذ الزاد مباح، أو ينوي به عون مسلم أو إغاثة ملهوف ونحو ذلك، فالأخذ أفضل. وإن كان منفردًا قوي القلب بالله سبحانه يشغله الزاد عن عبادة الله تعالى فالترك أفضل. فتفهم هذه الجملة واحتفظ بها راشدًا، وبالله التوفيق. If it is said which action is better, taking or not taking provisions, know that it all depends on the situation. If a leading figure wants to show that taking provisions is permissible, or intends to help Muslims, or to assist a needy person and the like, it is better to take provisions. However, if a man travels alone and his heart is strong in the remembrance of God, but taking provisions procedures. But taking provisions preoccupies his mind and distracts him from worshipping God. It is better not to take provisions. You must understand this difference and keep it in mind. Success comes from God alone. Then, of course, some of the ramifications of the second accident are dangers and fears associated with it, and the possibility of desire or pertinent intentions and goals. The safest way is in placing full trust in God and leaving it all to Him. الله إذا النهار الثاني الأخطار وردت وقصودها وإنما كفيتها في التفويض فعليك بتفويض الأمر كله إلى الله سبحانه وذلك لأمرين. So what are these two reasons for this? The first, لطمأنينة القلب في الحال، فإن الأمور إذا كانت خطيرة مبهمة لا يدرى صلاحها من فسادها تكون بها مضطرب القلب هائم النفس لا تدري تقع في صلاح أو فساد. فإذا فوضت الأمر كله لله تعالى علمت أنك لا تقع إلا في صلاح وخير، فتكون آمنا من الخطر والآفة والمخالفة، مطمئن القلب في الحال. وهذه الطمأنينة والأمن والراحة في القلب غنيمة عظيمة. وكان شيخنا then he mentions like he wanted to support his argument by poetry that his شيخ من حرماني Haramain al-Juwayni recited. So let's basically go ahead with the English translation and then we read the poetry. So some of the ramifications of the second accident are dangers and fears associated with it, and the possibility of desires of desire pertinent intentions and goals. The safest way is in placing full trust in God and leaving it all to Him. It is your duty and trust all affairs to God Most High. There are two reasons for this. The first is to have the heart attain the state of serenity and tranquility. When the affairs of life become complicated and difficult and good cannot be distinguished from evil or right from wrong, he whose heart lacks serenity and tranquility becomes anxious. He cannot distinguish good from evil and right from wrong. However, when all affairs are entrusted to God, you certain that nothing but good things will happen. You will therefore be immune from dangers, afflictions, and fears. This kind of serenity, peace, and contentment in the heart is a precious and great treasure. Our Master. Now we come to the poetry, but maybe for a second I would like to insert here the verse from the Quran. وأنفقوا في سبيل الله ولا تلقوا بأيديكم إلى التهلكة. وأحسنوا إن الله يحب المحسنين. This particular verse, it's the context for this is really spending on the for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and this covers practically all good activities, giving the orphans, giving the needy, building schools and clinics and universities and research centers. But the so despite the context, which is about spending for the sake of God, the if you take only that middle phrase, وَلَا تُلْقُوا بَيْدِكُمْ إِلَى التَّهْلُكَةِ, do not really throw your hands into destruction. Yes, if you take this particular phrase, the ulama, despite its context, which is about spending for the sake of God, they said that it covers all you know, possibilities. Do not throw your hands to perdition, to death. Do not really, in the name of trust in God, do not really cause imminent death, going to the desert and in the heat of the summer in the Gulf region when it hits. There are certain countries there that is almost 50 in the shade, and it could be much higher in the sun. People die anyhow when they suffer from dehydration. And I remember once I was in a Gulf country, and I was told by some journalists that laborers from Southeast Asia, they die from the heat strokes. They do sometimes work probably even more at night rather than during the day. But if you choose to go to the desert under these circumstances, when the heat is above 50 in the shade, which is in reality even higher, it's tantamount to walking in a snowy area when the temperature is minus 50. It does happen officially if you are in Alberta, Canada, and if it is minus 50, then you don't work. It's one shouldn't work outside. So if you are inside a mall, that's a different story. If you are inside the office, that's a different story. But working outside, and by the way, it's at minus 26 Celsius. If you throw boiling water, it will come down frozen. So you are not allowed, because العبرة بعموم اللفظ وليس بخصوص السبب. The general, the immediate meaning, the literal meaning, the apparent meaning of this middle phrase about not throwing one's hands to perdition, to do not cause yourself to die, then one shouldn't. Then one becomes obligatory to take provisions, and to take even if you are traveling with camels, if you are alone, and you shouldn't. The Prophet ﷺ advised against traveling alone. If you have to, then it should be more than one animal, just in case if one of the animals basically die in the middle of nowhere. And today, rather than only one person, one four drive, you know, wheel. There should be another person from a distance. At any rate, I simply do not feel comfortable about going to the, you know, yes, the ajal is in the hands of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, but one should not really go to the desert if it is really a deadly adventure. There's no need at any rate. Now the poetry of Imam Ghazali's Sheikh Imam Al-Harmain Al-Juwayni, Abu Ma'ali Al-Juwayni, he said, إن من كان ليس يدري أفي المحبوب نفع له أو المكروه لحري بأن يفوض ما يعجز عنه إلى الذي يكفيه الإله البر الذي هو بالرأفة أحنى من أمه وأبيه. He who does not know whether that he desires is a good or an abomination, it is appropriate to delegate that which he does not know to him who is sufficient, God the charitable, whose kindness is greater than that of his mother and father. The second reason. حصول الصلاح والخير في الاستقبال وذلك لأن الأمور بالعواقب مبهمة وكم من شر في صورة خير وكم من ضر في حلية نفع وكم من سم في هيئة شهد وأنت الجاهل بالعواقب والأسرار فإذا أردت الأمور قطعا وأخذت فيها باختيارك متحكما فما أسرع ما تقع فيه أو ما تقع فيها ذاك وأنت لا تشعر. The second reason is to attain virtue in the future because the eventual outcome of affairs is not known. Many a time an evil may be disguised in a good image and many good things may be perceived in an evil image. Many times poison may look like honey, and you should, or you may not know its true nature. You are not aware of the outcomes of the affairs and the mysteries behind them. Therefore, when you want to handle affairs in accordance with your own will, you will expedite your failure and destruction, but you do not realize it. I think we need to still unpack this paragraph after just immediately after the these three lines of poetry. Inshallah, we'll continue tomorrow. Jazakallah khairan. Subhanallah, Muhammad. أشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وأشهد أن محمدا رسول الله. السلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.